All right, we'll call this meeting to order. Start with the roll call, Mr. Coley.
Commissioner Askew.
Here.
Commissioner Hamilton.
Here.
Commissioner Thompson.
Here.
Commissioner Worden.
Here.
And we'll note that Commissioner Herbert will be absent today and will hold for Commissioner Pennell and Small until they get here.
Ms. Pennell will be absent today due to illness.
Okay. All right. Very good.
All right.
We have a quorum.
Great. We have a quorum. That's good. Next, we need approval of the minutes. I need a motion.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Minutes are approved. Next, we have an official action. Resolution 1358, adopting a public records policy for the Knoxville Utilities Board. Now recognize Mickey Roach.
Commissioners, I'll remind you that for many, many years, we've been subject to the open records law and public meetings and all of the transparency issues of state government. But last year, they passed a new piece of legislation that requires board approval of our policy. So I'll recognize Elba Marshall to give you the details of that.
Thank you, Ms. Roach. Good afternoon, Commissioners. As Ms. Roach has mentioned, we have long been abiding by the Tennessee Open Records Act. And in 2001, we adopted a formal written policy. And as she also mentioned, there was a resolution law that was passed requiring all governmental agencies and their governing bodies to adopt a records public records policy by July 1st of this year. And you may be wondering, if there was a law, why in fact would they require the boards to also adopt the policy? And the simple answer is transparency. Some of you may have seen this in the paper earlier this week, and it illustrates very well what and how governmental agencies feel about their records. They're very protective of them. Some agencies are very good at abiding by the law and disclosing the appropriate information as is permitted by law. And then there's others that actually have artificial barriers that prevent people from accessing those records. And one report that was recently shared was about a school board that refused to release records because the person requesting the records simply didn't fill out the appropriate form. So as part of this new law, one of the things that was required is that the Office of Open Records Council not only publish a best practices guidelines, but also a model policy for entities to follow. Fortunately for KUB, this is something that we have been dealing with for probably since our existence in the law. And we get about four requests a month. And if you look over the last 3 years, we've had about 132 requests. And of those 132, all of those records have been provided with the exception of two. And those two records requests were not provided simply because they never existed. So looking at the provisions that were enacted, the intention here is to make this process very transparent to the requester. So as a requester, what do I have rights to receive, and what's that process in order to get that? So they want in their policy to outline the process for making requests, the response that you will receive as a requester from the organization, any fees associated with the request, as well as the name of the public records coordinator. And finally, making it available on the website. So again, we've always had a practice and a policy. So today, what we do is when we receive a records request, we have a form that individual completes. And they complete that form regardless if all they want to do is view those records or if they want to view the records and actually make a copy. So that is a change for us. One of the things that has occurred with this new law is they want to remove any of those artificial barriers. And so from that perspective, they're stating that if somebody simply wants to view records, then they shouldn't have to fill out the form. For our purposes in our practice, we will actually still collect that information over the phone or in writing, however is necessary. And then we will have the information we need to abide by the next provision, which is responding to that request. So when we respond to somebody who's made a request, We have 7 days to let them know when we will have those records available. So in that information, we'll let them know when those records will be available, how much we will charge them to make copies of those records, as well as our internal contact. So for those provisions, we don't have any changes. We are already doing that. And then as far as making it available on the website, today we don't have the policy on our website, but as part of this provision, it does require you to have a link on the homepage that takes you to your policy and to the forms. Should this policy be adopted today, then we would be able to have that actually on the website. So Resolution 1358 seeks to adopt the state's model policy with some minor changes specific to KUB. And that is, one of the first ones is a courtesy notification that we do. So when we receive a request today from somebody wanting our records, and we find that for all the laws that are available, we have to release that information, it's nothing that's being protected, then we notify our employees or the customer or the third party that we have received this request, who the request is coming from, and we give them a few days to respond to us. If they actually have an order of protection, it gives us an opportunity for them to notify us of that, and then we would take appropriate action in accordance with that protection. This resolution also provides the authority for the Audit and Finance Committee to make any changes as is necessary to the policy, as well as give the Ms. Roach the opportunity to add any procedures so that we can adhere to the policy and the law as well. Are there any questions?
All right, hearing none, I have a motion and a second to approve Resolution 1358 on first and final reading.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Coley, will you please call the roll?
Yes, sir. Commissioner Askew?
Aye.
Commissioner Hamilton?
Aye.
Commissioner Small?
Aye.
Commissioner Thompson?
Aye.
Commissioner Worden?
Aye.
Resolution 1358 is passed.
All right, next I'll recognize Minta Roach for our President's Report.
Hi. As you know, we take a lot of pride in the quality of the work that we do at KUB. When we put our minds to anything here, we do it well, and I'm very, very proud of what we do. But I was reminded 24 years ago, Larry Flynn became the GM of KUB, and he was in a car driving to Nashville with Jim Kurtz, who at that time was the head of the electric power area. And driving down the road, Larry said, "Jim, what keeps you awake at night?" And Jim said, "Downtown. Two substations are separate, they don't communicate, there's no redundancy." And that taught me a lesson about learning to ask the right questions and to make sure that what our people know, we know. So last year, the senior staff was talking, and we kind of had this mantra, it's what we don't know that might hurt us. So we asked ourselves, what don't we know that we could do better on if we just looked into it? So Eddie Black picked up the ball and became the owner of a quality initiative that we kicked off last May. And I'm going to recognize him to tell you about it and then also to introduce the other presenters that we have.
Thank you, Ms. Roach. Good afternoon, Commissioners. As Ms. Roach said, I was spending a few minutes talking about why we undertook this quality initiative, how we carried it out. Then you'll be hearing a series of many presentations by some of the managers on our front row here. And then finally, I'll be talking about the next steps in the process. You know, since we created the KUB Blueprint a couple of years ago, this has become our North Star about who we are as a company and what we do. Not surprisingly, what I'm going to be talking about today is featured as part of it. While you don't see the word quality in here, it does imply that we improve the value of our services through efficiency, innovation, and communication. Quality is kind of a nebulous word anyway. It's difficult to define. It's easy to see. It's easy to not see if it's not there. What we really kind of define it as is continuous and ongoing improvement. This is not a new concept at KUB. Back in the 90s, we created the four corporate objectives, which was the precursor to our KUB blueprint. And as you can see, do the basics better influenced an entire generation of KUB employees. When I say the basics, basically it's what makes us able to provide utility services to our customers. And this is even more important in these days of unprecedented activity with Century 2 going on. We wanted to send the message that it's not enough to do a lot of things. We need to do a lot of things well. So with that in mind, we convened the entire management group from the CEO on down to the rest of the managers and had an all-day session just to talk about this concept. And we had asked everyone who participated in this to think of two or three things prior to this workshop that had occurred in the previous 6 months that they could have done better. So the first exercise of the day was to have everyone write down their issues on a large sticky note and get up in front of the room and talk about it for about a minute so that everyone understood exactly what their issue was and could address that. They then stuck this up on the wall behind them, and at the end of that exercise, that 90-minute exercise, we had 82 could-have-done-better issues. Now, in my 38-year career at KUB, there have been several moments when I've been proud to be a member of KUB and part of our culture. And this was a highlight. To have everyone from the most senior VP to the most junior manager get up in front of God and Minta and everybody, as one person said, and give just a very candid, very honest appraisal about what they could have done better really speaks volumes about our culture. And so during that process, no one was defensive. There were no excuses. No one was afraid of being criticized. And as Ms. Roach said, during the session, we don't want to hide issues. We want to expose them so we can explore them. And that's really what this session was about. Once we had those 82 up there on the board, we categorized them into these six categories right here. And then we had groups, vice presidents and managers, attempt to define those a little bit more, talk about the contributing factors and this type of thing. For ownership, in addition to what you see up there, there was the issue of assumption. Sometimes we would assume that someone had ownership of an issue without really making it a formal handoff. And as a result, we got no ownership on some things. And so that was an area that we wanted to explore. Process and training, I think the key word there is discipline. To define, follow, and train procedures. We've got a lot of action-oriented people at KUB. If they see a problem, they want to jump into it and solve it. Sometimes we follow procedures, sometimes we don't. It's in that kind of bias for action. We identified the need to, let's stick to procedures so that we have more coordination when we have an issue and everyone knows what everyone else is doing. Also, I think key to this is the ability to question the adequacy of the procedures and revise as necessary to keep everything fresh and current so that we're addressing everything properly. Collaboration and communication, I think most of the focus is on the collaboration piece. Our communication group does a fantastic job of creating good communication pieces. Sometimes, though, it doesn't get to all the right people. We don't necessarily realize sometimes who all the stakeholders are in a particular situation, and so we wanted to work better on that. Urgency versus accuracy really gets to the heart of the reason that we were meeting as a group. Once again, we want to do things faster, we want to do more, but we also want to do them better, and that's really what that one got at. Knowledge transfer, with the number of long-tenured employees that we have at KUB, there's a lot of institutional knowledge that gets accumulated by certain individuals through the year. We have, you know, true subject matter experts in a number of fields: gas systems, water systems, electric systems, water treatment, IT systems, you know, anything like that. But we don't want to rely on two or three key individuals. We want to institutionalize that knowledge, document it so that everyone can take advantage of it, and also formally have a way of passing this knowledge from individuals to the company at large. And then the last one is follow-up. And this is, once again, is a discipline issue to bring things to closure. For every project that's approaching completion, there's two or three more that we're anxious to get started. And a lot of things, a lot of times it involves the same key individuals. So, you know, we have to have the discipline to completely bring something to closure before we start jumping in on new projects and pulling people off of that former one. So we ended the day with having the VPs meet with their managers in that same room, just little clusters of folks, and talk about what can you do in your department to adopt as a quality initiative to work on in the coming year. And so we ended the day by having the managers present what their issues were, and we gave them the go-ahead to create action plans around those, to continue the discussions with their VPs, and to start implementing those things. 4 months later, showing that we had adopted the follow-up issue, we had a session in September. This was a half-day session, but it was with the same group, CEO, all the management team. And this time we had the VPs present updates on all of the issues for all of the departments that reported to them. And to give you an idea of some of the things that we talked about, were these issues here that we'll be talking about today. And you can see it runs the gamut, from operational issues to support issues, technical issues. This crossed all barriers at KUB. And so this was truly a comprehensive effort. We're going to start off with manager presentations right now with one of the construction areas.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. I'm Jamie Davis. I manage our underground construction group. The issues that we brought up and ultimately formed initiatives out of are really based upon some of those things that I talked to you last month about our workforce planning initiatives. We've really been hiring a lot of folks, as we talked about last month, over the last 2 or 3 years, and it really caused us to take pause about how we're bringing those folks on board at KUB. You know, we've had a variety of different folks that come from a variety of different backgrounds and different levels of experience, and we wanted to ensure that they understood and were introduced appropriately to KUB's construction practices and processes. One of the things that we definitely needed to do better, and actually Eddie held up, I think that's my handwriting, earlier, was that we needed to drive a little bit better too. So spawning out of that was an opportunity for us to really kind of branch off of that and do some driver training. But both of those focused on our new hires and really focused on folks and their individual skills and their individual abilities to perform how we expect them and for them to demonstrate proficiency in those tasks. At the end of the day, the process really is as simple as labeling out all the tasks that as a construction tech they need to do and being sure that their supervisor and their crew leaders are getting plenty of observation points for them to demonstrate that they are capable of doing those tasks. After a period of time, we would then sign off and say that employee was certified, if you will, or able to do that task. Well, why did we need to do it? Well, again, and bringing those folks in, we knew that there was that varying degrees of experience and knowledge of maybe the way KUB wanted to do things. And historically, training has been on-the-job training. That makes complete sense, and it really still is the foundation of how we train our folks. But the gap that was presented really was about accountability. It was about ensuring that that individual construction tech had been addressed and knowing exactly what they were capable of doing. You very well may not perform a specific task for a number of months, but we wanted you to be ready when it came time to do it. And so as a result, this is helping us overcome those particular gaps. At the end of the day, one of the main reasons we're doing this is safety. Safety of the individual employee who's been performing the task, safety of their coworkers, and the public as well too. It caused us to think differently about how we train, and the picture on the right there is one way we did things a little bit differently. That's a driving simulator, very similar to what we all experienced back in high school, except maybe a little bit updated. Good news is technology's come a long way. And it really was a great safe environment for folks to get to feel and experience what it's like to drive a large commercial vehicle in a safe place with certified trainers. There, we partnered with our Safety and Technical Services group over a week or 2 week period, brought in our folks for about a 4 or 8 hour session depending on their experience, and they got to experience that kind of environment in which we've really never done that before. Out of that, we really started on the driving end to challenge ourselves about how do we get better at driving. And so we kind of spawned off of our onboarding of our construction techs and said, well, let's focus in on driving in that regard. So again, a form, we developed that with different checkpoints, an opportunity for observation. The process for a construction tech as they come into KUB is to get their commercial driver's license or their CDL, And historically, that's kind of where things would end. What we have come to kind of say is well, getting a CDL does not necessarily mean you're proficient. And kind of oversimplifying it is, when I got my driver's license when I was 16, I wasn't necessarily a good driver. I had demonstrated some skills and abilities to pass the test, but I still needed my folks to give me some good guidance and grow me as a good driver. Well, that's what we're kind of going with that attitude here with our folks too, is until they've had the amount of seat time, observation from their coworkers, their crew leader, their supervisor, we want to be sure that they are indeed both we're comfortable with them driving and that they themselves are comfortable driving. And so at the end of the day, our goal there is to reduce motor vehicle accidents. It's one-on-one, just like the construction onboarding program. You can see a picture here of one of our new hires they're working with his trainer there. What we do is we have our existing staff. Some of our guys that are good drivers and enjoy training. On days in which are maybe not optimum construction days, we go down to our Riverside property, again, practice in a safe environment. Specialized training like backing a trailer, loading a trailer with a backhoe, backing with that backhoe on that trailer. Just things that maybe, you know, they might feel uncomfortable with and want some extra practice on in that regard. Again, competency must be demonstrated to us and us sign off on that before we turn them loose and drive independently on their own. And good news here too about this is in the process of developing this program, working again with our safety and technical services folks, we found a third party that kind of does this training as a profession. So we're going to pilot that with our next group of hires. So we're hoping to improve on our process. The good news is that both programs are showing early results, both qualitatively and quantitatively. We've heard from our last round of new hires that I've never been trained this way for our construction job. I've never been shown the ropes like this and understanding what the company expects of me. And so we're very pleased on that. Quantitatively, we were able to get the CDLs for this class faster than we have in years past, and we think that's a direct result of the program. You never want to count your chickens, I'm knock on wood. Our stats on driving are indeed better right now. We've had fewer accidents this year, fiscal year to date, than we've had last year. We hope that that's a result of these programs. And the good news too is that as we have started some of these, others around the company have seen kind of what we're doing, like the concept, and hopefully will expand into other areas of KUB. So hopefully they'll feel free to steal from us and take this into other areas.
Yes. I have a question more so a comment. You know, I'm glad to hear you when you started talking, because I think sometimes we do these quality assurance initiatives and we find the issues, right? But we don't necessarily then tie that back into either the human capital needs,
right,
or the operational barriers that prohibit some of those things from happening. So when you started talking, it was one of my questions that written down. And so to hear you talk about what we're doing now, we identified an issue and then we put the things in place to help rectify that. That was awesome. And to see the CPA, as we want someone who works in business school to see a CPA handle underground construction. That's good. It's baffling to me.
They don't know quite what to do with me.
Thank you, Dave. I appreciate that.
It reminded me of when I taught my kids to drive in the cemetery. I feared they couldn't kill anybody.
Great
Well, good afternoon. I'm John Williams, in my role as assistant to CFO. Mark and I are responsible for our procurement, our storeroom areas, among other areas. Michelle Wilson, who's our acting manager of procurement, is unable to be here, so I get the opportunity to share one of their quality initiatives on her behalf. As we talk a lot about with Century 2, our inventory and supply needs have certainly grown over the years. And in fact, today, we're responsible for about 3,500 individual inventory items, you know, two storerooms.